Hello, my dear students, myself Sheikh Gulnaz. Now I am here with the topic of meaning and types of economy for the students of 8th standard part 2. Dear students, in the last class we have discussed about the meaning and types of economy, isn't it? The introduction we learned meaning and what is the meaning of economy we learned. What is the meaning of economy, students? Let's revise, okay? An economy may be described as a man-made organization for the satisfaction of human wants. What is economy, students? Here we learn that economy is described as a man-made organization for the satisfaction of human wants. Okay, so next we learned in the last classes described many of these economist ways how they describe economy. We learned there and also the features of economy. And now here we are next moving forward with the next topic, that is the types of economics we have. That is three types of economies was there, students, we learned in the last class. They were capitalist, socialist and mixed economy. So in the last class we discussed about the capitalist economy and the features of capitalist economy. Now let us see about the socialist economy here, students. Here you can see socialist economy, students, when productive resources are owned. When productive resources are owned and controlled by the government to promote the overall interest of the society, it is called socialist system. Here, students, how can I explain you means this topic is when the producer is producing the goods, for example, so that is owned, that all the activities of producing the goods and services that was controlled by the government to promote the overall interest of the society, it is called socialist system. Here, students, they control overall full. We can say the handler here is government. Okay, so in this system, a central planning agency plans and regulates various economic activities in the interest of all. So the socialist economy has the following features. Students, here in socialist economy, a central planning agency plans. Central planning means here the government will plan the agencies and regulates various economic activities in the interest of all. So here they look for all welfare, all individual in the society. So now let us see what are the features of socialist economy here. Here, students, collective ownership of means of production and wealth. Here, there is a collective ownership is there of means of production and wealth. Here, who is handling your student? The government. So the government will take all over responsibility of the citizens. In a socialist economy, the government owns the means of production on behalf of the people. All wealth is collectively owned. So here, students, if the government is owning the controlling the countrymen, so they have to look after all individual, isn't it? So next feature is social welfare objective. The control is under the control is all under government. So what the government will provide us? They will look for all. Okay, so social welfare objective is another feature of socialist economy. So yes, students, social welfare objective, the government act on the behalf of all the people to maximize their welfare. So here, students, the main aim of the government is to satisfy all wants of the public. So the government decides about the type and level of the output and the distribution of the same, keeping in the view and broader social welfare of the people. So here, students, the main aim of the government is to provide the basic necessities and to satisfy the human wants, all individual. So they will look after that. So keeping in view the broader social welfare of the people. So they will think about more about the peoples and their wants. So next feature of socialist economy is central planning. So the identification of national priorities and allocation of resources to meet them is done through economic planning. So here, students, the central planning identification, it is an identification of national priorities. So it will give first priority to the government. So according to the government, it will be run. So and the allocation of resources to meet them in good through economic planning. So here, students, they provide the resources to meet them in or to done through economic planning. So whichever goods they are providing us, so they will look for their economy also. So they have to feel that economic, so they have to be minimized. So compromisations will be there, students, in this, we can say. So for this purpose, the central planning authority is created, which keeps the national priorities and availability of resources in mind and allocates resources. So students, here for this purpose a central planning authority is created. Here in this, a central planning authority is created which keeps the national priorities and availability of resources in mind and allocates the resources on basis of keeping by students, by the method of keeping everything in their mind, they will regulate the plan and they will produce the goods. So all economic decisions regarding the production and consumption and investment are made by the government, keeping in mind the present and future needs. So students, here in this, we can say this is in the last class we learned about the capitalist. So it, instead of capitalist, socialist government is very good compared to that. How, students? Here the government is looking for all individual. So here, students, in this socialist economy, students, the investment and their consumption, production, all these decisions regarding all these economic activities, the government keeping this in their mind for and thinking about present and future needs. So the market and prices have little role to play in socialist economics. The market prices is little role. They have small role in this. Not small, very little. So next feature of socialist economy is reduction in inequalities. So students, here in our private business, we can give some to our friends, we will give them in less money and all. For others, we will raise the money. But here in capital, socialist economy, students, the reduction in inequalities. So here they will be all are equal. There is no inequality in this economy. So here, student, non-existence of private property and accumulation reduces economic inequality in a socialist economy. So here, students, they will not do the inequalities between the peoples. Here they know us, these, that and all. So here the main intention of government is to look after all. So here in the eyes of government, they all are equal. So they will not do the inequalities. So next feature of socialist economy is no class conflict. Here, student, all are co-workers in socialist society and there is only the working class. Hence, there is no class conflict. So here, student, the persons, those who are doing business in this, so there will be a no class conflict. This person belong to that class, this, that, and there is no inequalities and there is a no class conflict. Why? Because here, the main intention is the persons, those who are doing work, we are paying to them, isn't it? So whether they are doing in another way and they are doing in another way, no. So they all are doing the same work means there is no class conflict is there. Though they are doing the same work, so the government will not do the class conflict here, students. So socialism, which was a prominent idealism after the Second World War and embraced the countries like Russia, China and many Eastern European countries. So here, student, this prominent idealism means we can say the good idea for the Second World War and embraced the countries like Russia, China and many Eastern European countries. But the wave of liberalization since the 1990s has made almost all these countries to allow private sector to participate extensively in economic activities. So these liberalization, students, here since the 1990s has made almost all these countries to do their private businesses and all. So nowadays, students, you can see all are working for themselves. There is they are not thinking about the groupism and all, just they are thinking of their selfish needs, isn't it? So they, people started of doing the private businesses. So here next we have the another type of economy, that is mixed economy. A mixed economy combines the good features of both capitalism and socialism. Here, students, we can see the both type of government is there. Both type of economy is present in mixed economy. We can see in mixed economy both capitalism economy also and socialism economy also. So it has a combination of elements of both free enterprise or capitalist economy as well as a government controlled socialist economy. It is defined as an economic system where the public and private sectors coexist. Cooperate. So the features of mixed economy are as follows here. Coexistence of public and private sector is the first feature of mixed economy, students. So the private enterprises that owns production units and works with profit motivation exist along with the production units owned by the government which work with welfare objectives. So students, here in this type of economy we can see the government which they are producing the goods for the welfare of people. So here they own that, they purchase that goods and send it to the persons by taking extra rupees, extra. So they will be benefited for them also and for the public also. So this is nothing but a mixed economy, students. Okay. So the economic activities are generally demarcated. So the government adopts a planning mechanism to direct the utilization of resources of the economy for overall development. So here, students, the government activities that the government, what they are producing to the for the welfare of people. So they will think of that also mechanism correctly, whether they are doing that planning correctly or not, and the direct utilization of the resources that overall development will be under the government control. So they have to look after all these things. So next, it also regulates the activities of the private sector through various policies such as licensing policy, taxation policy, price policy, monetary policy and fiscal policies. So these are the things, though they are doing that business, means students, they are ready to pay the prices like taxes and all, we can say. They have to adopt the policy of licensing. These policies they used to adopt. So these come under private sector. So individual freedom. So here they have the individual freedom. Next feature of mixed economy. Individuals are free to choose occupations and consumption as per their choice. As per their choice, they used to consume the produce the goods and all. So next, but producers are not given the freedom to exploit consumers and laborers. So government exercises regulations and controls keeping in mind the welfare of the people. But within these rules, regulations and restrictions of the government, the private sector enjoys complete freedom. So here, students, government exercises regulations and controls keeping in the mind the welfare of the people, but within these rules and regulation restrictions of the government, the private sector enjoys complete freedom. Though they are adopting the regulations, rules and regulation which the government will be gives them, but then also they will enjoy the policy as per there, because there is a freedom for individual. So next we have economic planning. The next feature of mixed economy is economic planning. Planning mechanism is used by the government to prepare development plans and decide the roles to be played by the private and public sectors in the development of the economy. While the public sector is under the direct control of the government and works as per production targets and plans formulated, the private sector is supported through incentives, support and subsidize to work as per the national priorities. Thus, students, the government is allowing them to do the business, but according to the rules and regulations they have promoted. Thus, we are living in India, students, as per our government we can do whatever we want as per the government rules and regulation. Whatever we want means for our satisfaction and all, we can do the works. Whatever business we want, we can, but according by taking the permission of the government. So isn't it, students? So this is all about the economic planning. So next we have the price mechanism. The government policies influence the prices significantly in a mixed economy. There are administrative prices for the public sector units, example railways in India, and the government provides price subsidized to help the weaker sections. So Indian economy is a classic example of mixed economy. So the areas of functioning of public and private sectors are well defined, and economic planning is a key activity for achieving development. So here, students, price mechanism, in this the government policies influence the prices significantly. Importantly, they will give the prices for mixed economy. So next, here what happened after giving their prices and all, there are administered prices for public sector units. So students, example, we can say railways in India. for the poor peoples, for the depending upon the classes and all they used to. And the government provides price subsidies to help the weaker sections also. So Indian economy is a classic example of mixed economy, students, we can say. So the areas for functioning of public and private sectors are well defined. So, and economic planning is a key activity for achieving development. So next we have the types of economy on the basis of level of development. Here students, we learned about the three types of economic, these types of economies. But here now let us see the types of economics on the basis of level of development. Okay, so on the basis of level of development, economics can be classified into two categories, that is developed economy and developing economy. So now let us see, students, what is developed and developing. Developed countries have higher national and per capita income, high savings and investment, and therefore high rate of capital formulations. They have highly trained human resources, better civic facilities, good health and sanitation facilities, low birth rate, low death rate, and low infant mortality. They also possess well-developed industrial and social infrastructure, including strong financial and capital markets. People in developed countries have high standard of living. Students, the countries which are developed in economy, they have higher national income. So as they have development, students, they knows every idea and they have been that formulated that ideas and all. So they will be having high savings and investment, and therefore high rate of capital formulations. Capital, it is nothing but students, in the standard language we call money as capital. So they have highly trained human resources. So as the country that is developed, so they will be having the highly qualified employers will be there. So better civic facilities will be there, good health and sanitation facilities, low birth rate and death rate will be there in developed countries. So they also possess well-developed industrial and social infrastructure, including strong financial and capital markets. People in developed countries have high standard of living. We can say, students, example America, that is a developed country, we can say. See, okay. So next we have developing countries are low on the ladder of development. As developing countries, students, still they have to develop. They are underdeveloped. They are also called underdeveloped, backward or poor countries. We can see one example is our India only. So the national and per capita income in this country is low. They have backward agricultural and industrial sectors with low savings, investment and capital formations. They have low standard of living, poor health and sanitation, high infant mortality, high birth and death rates, and poor infrastructures. This is all about the students, which countries are underdeveloped. On the basis of types of economy, on the basis of level of development, we can see we have two types of economic, that is developed and underdeveloped. In developed, we can see everything, the standard of living of the people is good. They have high standard of living. But the countries which are developing, underdeveloped, they will be having the people will be poor and their health will be not good and all. These are the problems which we can see in developing countries, that is nothing but underdeveloping countries. So now let us see India as a mixed economy. Okay. So here, India is a classic example of mixed economy with both public and private sectors operating within the planning and regulatory framework of the government. So the need to achieve higher and faster development, ensuring better living standard to all classes of people, compelled to India adopt a mixed economy system soon after independence. So the important features of Indian mixed economy systems are. So here, students, as the government wanted all for the individual, and also they have to develop for them. The government was providing everything according to the framework where peoples will be follows that. So here the main intention of the government was to rise the standard of living of the people. So soon after the independence that we got, so the government started to develop. So now let us see the features of mixed economy in India. Coexistence of public and private sectors, we learned just now only. Planned development will be there. So the broad activities of Indian plans are economic growth, modernization, self-reliance, social justice, elimination of poverty, creations of conditions of near full employment and satisfaction of basic needs like food, clothing, shelter, education, health, etc. So here students, we can see plan development. 5-year plans were prepared within the framework of the directive principle of the state policy to rebuild economy and lay foundation of industrial and scientific progress. So the planning commission was set up in 1950 to prepare plans for all round development of the country and people. So the planning commission has so far prepared and implemented 12 5-year plans and many annual plans. In 2015, the planning commission has been replaced by NITI, National Institutions for Transforming India Ayog. So here students, plan development is nothing but once in a 5-year the government will set up a committee, a meeting for the developing of the nation. So according to that we used to perform 5 years, we used to formulate that ideas and all. So here students, in that this commission was started in the year 1950 after the independence. We started this policy in India. The planning commission has so far prepared and implemented 12 5-year plans. Okay. So next, annual plans. In 2015, the planning commission has been replaced. Another name, that is NITI, National Institution for Transforming India Ayog. So the broad activities, they keeping in the mind these activities. What were the plans for India? To have economic growth, modernization, self-reliance, social justice, elimination of poverty, creation of condition of near full employment and satisfaction of basic needs like food, clothing, shelter, education, health, etc. So these were the broad objectives of the planning commission. So now next feature is the role of public sector. The role of public sector has played an important role in the development of Indian economy. It increased the pace of economic growth and reduced disparities of income and wealth. It has prominently contributed to the development of infrastructure, establishment of basic and heavy industries, dispersed industries in several backward regions, and promoting trading and marketing activities including international trade. So here students, public role here it was very important, as the public role company, public business, they have been started. What happened here? India started to develop slowly. So we started doing trade with the other countries, international countries also. So, and dispersed industries also, development of infrastructure, establishment of basic heavy industries, as everything. So next, private sector, let us see. It is not only includes industries but agriculture, small industry, trade and great deal of activities in housing and construction activities as well. It provides employment to 3/4 of our manpower. Many policies and laws have been enacted to control private sector. Students, here in public sector we saw that the development infrastructure was there, establishment of basic heavy cities was there, industries we have started for the several backward regions, and we promoted trading and all for other countries also. In form of agriculture, students, the things which we are consuming here, for example the things we are growing in our country, we used to send it for trade and business. We used to export the goods also. So that comes under the public sector. Next we have private. So the peoples, those who are not satisfied with the things and all, they started their own businesses and all. Slowly they used to develop, and it provides the employment to 3/4 of our manpower. So next we have, that is coordination between public and private sector is there. Both the public and private sector have been worked together for achieving the goals set by the planning commission. So here students, both the public and private, they both are working for the together to achieve the goals. They started to cooperate. So however, the today role of public sector is declining and more space is provided to the private sector. So next we have, that is performance of the public sector in India. The public sector was given dominant role so that it could control the commanding heights of the economy. So achievement of rapid economic development, reduction of concentration of economic power, balanced regional development, employment generations, import substitutions and export promotion and resources mobilization were the key objectives of public sector promotions. So here students, performance of public sector in India is, we can see the public sector was given dominant role, changing role, so that it could control the commanding heights of the economy. The thing with commanding, whatever commanding heights is there of the government, to give them answer. So achievement of the rapid economic development, that is the reductions of concentration of economic power, balanced regional development is there, employment generation, import substitutions and export promotions and resource mobilizations were the key objectives of public sector promotion. So here students, what were the objectives here? We can see in sector promotion was to employment, to raise the employment generations, and regional development, balanced regional development. So all to look after all. So accordingly, public sector made significant important contribution to the country economy by filling the gaps in the industrial sector. So generating employment and achieving balanced regional development, the growth profile of public sector has been very impressive. So it has a good hold on the commanding heights in terms of investment in key sectors like steel, electricity, generation and petroleum. So students, here the persons, those who have started the private businesses, so what happened here students, they started to give employment. So for the people, those who are unemployed, so they can work in private industries and also they can achieve, so they can earn. So this was started. And here what happened is the investment, the commanding heights, what they are investing the money for the objectives, in keeping in the mind that like steel, electricity, generations and petroleum. Okay, so it has a good hold. In these industries they started to work. So but the public sector did not show better financial performance or profitable because of many critical problems like defective pricing policy, excessive political interference, delays in decisions making, overstaffing, lack of accountability and underutilization of capacity. So here students, because of this what happens, many problems were there. So because of that it has been not worked properly public. So like defective pricing policy will be there. So one person is demanding for this, problems will be occurred if we are starting. Then another problem was excessive political interference was there, delays in decisions making, and overstaffing will be there obviously if they are doing public elements. Lack of accountability will be there, and underutilizations of capacity will be there. So hence, since 1980s, various efforts were made to improve performance, and with the economic reform process initiated since 1991. So the privatization has become a key policy of the government. The government is selling its shares of public sector industries, which is called disinvestment. So because of that, what happened, they started the private businesses only. So the government is selling its shares of public sector industries, which is called disinvestment. So this is all about the economy and types of economy, students. The main thing here you have to learn is what are the types of economy, that is important, and meaning and features. If you got this, you got everything. Okay, so next you have, that is exercises there, students, for you. Fill in the blanks with the suitable words. Economy refers to the nature of organization of dash. NITI Aayog was set up in dash. Free enterprise is a basic feature of dash economy. Good example of capitalist economy is dash. Coexistence of public and private sector is seen in dash. Answer the following after discussing them in groups. What is an economy? Mention the features of capitalist economic system. What are the defects of capitalist system? What is meaning? What is planning? How are economics classified on the basis of level of development? How does government regulate the activities of the private sector in a mixed economy? What is disinvestment? Why is India considered a developing economy? So students, if you have any doubt and any question relating to this topic, you can ask me. Okay, so thank you for watching my video, students.